climax of creation. Because what is unique about us making the image of God is that we have voices that can actually articulate God's glory. The whole creation declares his glory, but we can sing it and we can speak it because we're made in the image of God. It's the purpose of our lives, to glorify God, to enjoy him forever. That, I would suggest, is a pretty good definition of worship. When we worship God, we glorify him, we enjoy him together, we are doing what we were created to do. Psalm 19 again says that the heavens have no voice, no audible voice, but we do. We are made to be singers. It's one of the aspects of being made in the image of God. So what do? We celebrate the mystery, the majesty, as we were thinking this morning, the awesome glory of God. Take, for example, the great doctrine of the Trinity. There's no God like our God. The only God that exists is the triune God, awesome, majestic, and mysterious, one God in three persons, so that the Father is God, and the Son is God, and the Spirit is God, and yet not three gods, but one God, eternally in loving relationship, out of that relationship pouring out his glory. And we declare that with our voices, we sing about it. Number two, we sing secondly because we're commanded to sing. We're commanded to sing. So I mentioned this morning there are at least 50 commands, particularly in the book of Psalms, but elsewhere through the Bible, where there's a command. We do it because we're told to do it. Just take, and again you can do this when you get home, take the last five Psalms I mentioned earlier, so the Hallelujah Psalms. So Psalm 146, I will sing as long as I live, says the psalmist, for my whole life. Through all the seasons of life, Psalm 147, it is good, it is pleasant, it is fitting to praise God. Psalm 148, we mentioned a moment ago, at least 12 or 13 times, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Psalm 149, I will sing a new song to the Lord. Psalm 150, the very last verse of the Psalter, look at it again, everything that has breath, praise the Lord. In other words, we sing God's praises even if we don't feel like it. I mentioned this morning, we want our hearts to go with our words. And we want to prepare our hearts, but sometimes our emotions are flat. And sometimes we say, well, I don't feel like singing this morning. And that's whether we're members of a congregation or members of a music team. But we sing, even when we don't feel like it, because it's God's command. Think of the analogy of prayer. There have been things I've been praying for 20 years. I've been praying for certain conversions for 20 years. The people that I pray for are not converted yet. And there are times when I trouble over that, and I worry over that, and I think, well, how does prayer work? And I go around in my mind, and I'm confused about the whole theology of prayer. And then I come back to what is my favorite verse on prayer. You'll never guess it, or it's pretty simple. My favorite verse on prayer, you have not, because you ask not. And I say to the Lord, well, I don't understand how prayer works, but I'm coming to you, I'm asking. I want this person to be converted. I don't understand all the mysteries of your sovereign will. I just want that. And you've told me that's not because you want it. It's the same as singing. We sing because we're commanded to sing. And very often when we're commanded, we do it, then the joy comes. But we don't sing because we feel like it. We sing because there's a commanded scripture. It's a matter of obedience in the end. Remember one Kentish preacher some years ago describing a funeral I had at their church, and it was one of those horrendous funerals of a child, a stillborn baby. And there's this tiny little coffin. And the leader of the music group was the dad of the little child. And he said, I want to lead the singing. I want to choose the hymns, and I want to lead the singing. And the pastor said, sure, yeah, I do, because although we feel broken-hearted, we want to confess that we trust in God. He said, they stood there in the church and this music group, they sang, the congregation, tears running down everybody's cheeks. Praise the Lord. His way is perfect. Ascribe greatness to our God, the rock. His work is perfect. All his ways are just. You feel like singing that? No. But we do it in faith and in trust, because we're commanded. Number three, here's the third reason. singing is a dominant thing both in the Bible and in the history of the church. Now we could spend the rest of our time looking at what the Bible says about singing. As I mentioned earlier, there are at least 500 references to singing and music in the Bible, some remarkable ones. My favourite verse, I think, on singing in the Old Testament is Zephaniah chapter 3 and verse 17. Do you know what that says? Anyone remember Zephaniah 3 and verse 17? Did you know there was a Zephaniah? Yeah? Absolutely, excellent. The Lord himself will rejoice over you with singing. One of the reasons we sing is that our God is a singing God. An amazing Zephaniah chapter 3 verse 17. In the New Testament, you've got five songs in Luke chapter 1 to 2. In John 4, Jesus commands, or Jesus says the Father is looking for those who will worship him. And 500 references in the Bible, so it's not a minor theme. You can't say, well, it's not very important. No, it's a major theme. And if you look at the history of the church, now I love playing song, but playing song was basically a performance that people listened to. One of the things that the Reformation introduced was congregational singing. In fact, one of the charges against John Huss when he was burnt at the stake for heresy was that he encouraged congregational singing. Now, you have to pay some price for leading the singing in your church, but I don't know burning you at the stake. You probably got one or two deacons who quite like to do that, but be that as it may, you know, that's part and parcel of what it means to be the church. And here's a PhD in the waiting. Look at the relationship between revival and singing. It's a huge relationship. When revival came to Wales in 1904, 1905, someone once asked Evan Roberts, do you think that revival could ever come to England? And it's spreading wide like wildfire. Would it ever come to England? And slightly tongue-in-cheek, he said, oh, can the English sing? In other words, you'll never have a revival when people don't sing. Every revival, well, not quite true, but many revivals have been touched by singing. So it's a great Bible theme. Number four, singing celebrates our salvation. Yesterday I was in London at a theological seminary talking to 19 young men who are preparing for pastoral ministry. And part of my job there was to talk to them about the dangers and the joys and the encouragements of being in pastoral ministry. And the question I asked them right at the beginning was this: what's the single most important thing in your life? Some of you are pastors today. I wonder whether you could come up with an answer. What's the single most important thing in your life? Or as a music leader, or as a musician, or as a singer, what's the single most important thing in your life? Shall I tell you what it's not? It's not that you're a pastor. It's not that you're a singer. It's not that you're up front. The single most important thing in your life is that you're saved. There's nothing more significant, nothing more important than that. When my wife became very ill, we faced the possibility that I'd have to give up preaching. And for me, that was like, I don't know what, it was like the most massive bereavement. It looked as if I would have to care. We've got three kids, another one on the way. I'd have to care for them, I'd have to give up. And I had a battle with God. I remember going for a long walk and screaming at God and saying, you know, how could you ask me to do that? In the end, the Lord didn't ask me to do that, but what he did ask me to do was to look at the possibility and to come to the point where I got down on my knees and said, God, if I can never preach another sermon, I've still got treasure in heaven, I still belong to you. And Martin Lloyd Jones, who was on his deathbed, was asked by, I think it's by Ian Murray, how do you cope, Doctor? How do you cope with the fact that you can no longer preach as you once did? Maybe the greatest preacher of the 20th century. And the doctors referred him to, I think in Luke 19:10, it is when the disciples come back and they say, Lord, it's amazing. Even the evil spirits are subject to you. He said, don't rejoice that the evil spirits are subject to you. Rejoice rather that your names are written in heaven. We're saved. Isn't that wonderful? You can smile if you like. You can even say hallelujah. Or maybe not. What do we rejoice in? We rejoice in that we're chosen. We're awakened by the Holy Spirit. We're born again. We're justified and adopted. We are being sanctified. We will be glorified one day. One day sin will no longer not only be gone from our record, it will be gone from our lives. Isn't that wonderful? Why do we sing? We sing because we're saved and we're, dare I say, happy. And we want to. And we want to just tell people about the gospel. And we just want to say how wonderful it is. A few years ago, at the Keswick Convention, it was at a time when there was a lot of attack on the doctrine of the atonement. I don't know the details, but some of you remember people were writing books and kind of really attacking the idea that Jesus died in our place. And at that particular week at Keswick, there was a real kind of sense of you know, the church is under attack, and what we've cherished, that the cross of Christ is under attack. And I remember the preaching that week, it was of a very high quality. And we came to the last night. In those days, the last night at Keswick was always communion. And we met around the Lord's table, and it's quite difficult, 3,000 people in a tent distributing bread and wine and so on. But finally it was done, and we came to the end of the service, and somebody said the last amen. And before we finished, a single voice came from the congregation. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son. Blessed Lamb of God, Messiah. And they'd not got to the end of the first line before the whole congregation spontaneously raised their voices. It was one of those kind of electric shock down the spine moments. But it was the response of God's people saying the cross, Jesus crucified, Jesus risen from the dead, is more precious to us than life itself. How can we not sing, celebrating our salvation? Number five, singing cements truth in our lives. How are we doing for time? We're okay. We're almost halfway there. You still with me? I love your enthusiasm. Singing cements truth in our lives. Remember Colossians chapter 3, Paul says, let the word of God dwell in you richly. The word richly there literally means fully and thoroughly. Don't let the word of just God just glance off you. Make it part of your heart. Make it something that grips you and grabs you and holds your attention. How can the word of God dwell in us richly? Well, he says teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom. Okay, that's good. How do we do that, Paul? Well, obviously he's thinking of preaching, but in the context he actually says through or by speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. In other words, what's happening when the word of God is being proclaimed in song, it's being cemented in our hearts. It's not just the preaching that puts the word of truth in our hearts, it's the singing as well. Singing cements the truth of the gospel and biblical truth in our hearts. Spiritual health depends on spiritual truth. Some theology becomes the soundtrack of our lives. So here's one thing for you as worship group leaders, and I'm sure you did already. Make sure you connect with the preacher. Find out what he's preaching about. Find the main points. Find the thrust of the sermon. What's it about this week? What's the heart of the sermon? Not just the text, but the heart. What's he longing to see happen? And then you take the truth of the sermon and marry it with what you do in the singing. Put the two together, which people often do, don't they? I'm sure you do that already. John Newton was dealing with folk who didn't know the Bible very well. So you know, he wrote lots of hymns that were based on the message he was going to speak next Sunday. And it's fascinating looking at some of them. Some of them have a very good quality. Some of them are not. There's one that he wrote, I'm trying to remember the words, it just comes to me. It's about Jonah in the belly of the big fish, pretty horrendous place. And there's a stanza which runs something like, oh Lord, this is a wretched place, with neither book nor candle, nothing but fishes, tripes to eat, and fishes, tripes to handle. Now, Jonah, you've written better things than that. Okay. But at least the thought was there. Let's get people realizing how bad it would be to stay inside a fish. But actually, what does it mean? It means that in our singing, we should sing the great doctrines. I mean, there are some songs that are just lovely, short, kind of warm, heartwarming. Now, as we're gathered, Jesus is here. One with each other, Jesus is here. Well, there's great truth in that, but it's just just kind of little nuggets, but other songs with huge amounts of truth. And that's what we should do. We should be singing about the Trinity, the Incarnation, the Atonement, and the Resurrection, justification by faith, assurance, what it means to be a child of God, union with Christ. And what does singing do? Dare I say it, it makes us emotional about doctrine, doesn't it? It makes us feel doctrine. And there's a sort of a strange divorce between truth and feeling. And we think, well, theology, that's the sort of academic exercise, and singing, that's the emotional thing. Well, what does this do? It marries the two. We ought to feel our doctrines. We ought to feel deeply about the truth. Remember I said this morning, it's between emotion and emotionalism. Emotionalism is kind of bypassing the mind and just making people, you know, get all sort of whiffly. Is it such a word? Whiffly and waffly. Whereas what happens with true emotion is it comes to the mind, the truth, and then it moves the emotions and then it changes the will. So don't be afraid of emotion. Let's make great doctrines emotional. Number six, singing shapes and transforms our lives. One of the things that God uses to make us holy. In 2 Timothy, Paul talks about the purpose of the Word of God. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. In other words, the Bible isn't given just to explain a subject. The Bible is given to achieve an object, to correct us, to train us, to change us. One of the things I say to preachers is your task is not just to explain a subject. Now, if you're given an exposition, a correct exposition of a Bible passage, that's good. But what was the purpose of the passage? And is that your purpose? You want to achieve an object as well as teaching a subject. And singing should do the same. What are we doing when we sing? We are trying to call God's people to godliness, to holiness, to change. To change what we think, to change what we love, to change what we do. Calling people to love one another, calling people to trust the Lord, calling people to experience forgiveness or assurance. And it's more than just kind of between your eyes, you know, bang, bang, bang. It's showing people Christ so that gazing at him, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, we're transformed, we're metamorphosized. My first church in Chippenham, the first series of sermons I ever preached was on the book of James. And I chose James because my philosophy of preaching in those days was a little bit like boxing. You have to hit them hard and knock them down and make them feel bad about themselves. I was very young at the time. And you know, if people go away feeling really challenged, then you've done a good job. So James is the kind of book that you can turn into that kind of. It's got all sorts of practical stuff. And I'm preaching with bang, bang, bang. After 6 months, I asked my editors, how did I do? How am I doing? And they were very gentle, very kind. We got to the last guy, one of the older elders. And he said, well, thank you very much. You know, I get a lot from your preaching. He said, but can I say something? And I said, yeah. He said, when I come to church some Sundays, I feel really bad, really low. And then I hear your preaching, I feel worse. He said, it would be wonderful sometimes if you didn't hit us between the eyes, but you just showed us Jesus. Never forgot best advice I think I've ever had. You don't change people by punching them in the solar plexus, you change people by showing Jesus. What are we trying to do in our singing? We're trying to exalt Christ, we're trying to point to him. We can't, as we thought this morning, we can't make him bigger than he is, but we can make the focus sharper. Magnify the Lord, we make, like a telescope, it doesn't make the moon bigger, it makes it clearer. That's what we should be doing in our preaching, that's what we should be doing in our singing. Number seven. Singing prepares us for battle, and it prepares us for the struggles of this life. A few months ago, I think it was last year actually now, I was preaching at a conference up in the north of Scotland, and amongst the Wee Frees. And the Wee Free, the Church, Free Church of Scotland, used to only sing metrical psalms. It's changed now, you can choose to sing hymns if you like, but still quite a few metrical psalms. I was talking to a guy there who was a Highlander and who loved metrical psalms. And I said, well, why do you love the metrical psalms? He said, well, you know when you're singing them, you're singing God's word, and that's great. He said, but the other thing is this, he said, when I come to some churches and I'm worshiping in the South, some songs are very triumphalistic. They're all kind of, isn't it wonderful, isn't it marvellous? Sometimes I don't feel like that. My other songs is that they cover the whole range of human experience. And actually, in our singing, we need to make sure we do that. Because what are we doing? We're arming God's people to face the trials and the troubles and the heartbreaks of this world. And sometimes when we are over-triumphalistic, what happens is that people go away feeling worse and guilty because they think, well, I don't feel like that. We had a lady who used to come to our church when I was in Worcester. And she left to go to a smaller church. And part of the reason was that she had a very tragic life. And she said, sometimes when I'm amongst your people, I'm overwhelmed. In this smaller church, we seem to be more sensitive. And I mean, that's a huge rebuke to me. It made me think of my own preaching. Are we actually preparing people for the battles that they face in this life? At least a third of the Psalms are lamentations. Now, they don't leave people lamenting. Almost all of them, maybe one exception, but almost all of them start in the dark and end in the light. But are we preparing God's people for the troubles and the trials that they face in this world? John Erickson, Johnny's story, tells how when she was first in the hospital, first diagnosed as quadriplegic, she was lying there and her friend came to visit her. And a friend said to her, what's it like? And Johnny said, it's terrible at night, I feel so lonely at night. So the friend hid. And in the night she kind of stayed and she just stayed next to Johnny. And she said at one point she just knelt next to the bed and into my ear very quietly, she sang, Man of Sorrows. What a name, the Son of God who came, ruined sins to reclaim. Hallelujah. What a saving. Johnny said those words sung quietly in the night. Took me to the cross and took me to the Saviour and took me to the side of Jesus. What are we doing? We should be going to prepare God's people for the trials of life. Three to go, number eight. Singing expresses our fellowship and it encourages us in our ministry together. Ephesians chapter 5, Paul talks, doesn't he, about being filled with the Spirit. And it's an ongoing command, being filled with the Spirit. How do you know if you're filled with the Spirit? Well, one of the signs will be that you will speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. There's something wonderfully vertical about singing. We are adoring God and we are praising God, but we're also talking to one another. We're encouraging one another. See the film Zulu? Are Christians allowed to watch Zulu? Do you remember where there's this little group of Brits and they're surrounded by this massive army and they're just about to be attacked and in a beautiful Welsh baritone voice they sing Men of Arlec. Do you remember that? You've not seen Zulu? Shame themselves. I mean, and you can kind of think, now I'd have preferred a machine gun personally, but be that as it may, in the midst of this, they're together and you kind of look down the line and your brothers are singing. What do we do when we come to sing? It's a corporate thing where we minister to one another and we encourage one another and we cheer one another on and we say, come on guys, let's go for it. We're surrounded with a great host of witnesses. Can I say something about singing? And this isn't a criticism, but it is something for you to take away and think about. I think there's something quite special about those moments when the musicians stop and even the singers that kind of play that, and you hear the voice of the congregation. And that's really important. Because sometimes the music, even if it's a very high quality, can be more significant than her voice. And we hear what we're singing, but it's not just me standing there and hearing and the Lord. It's actually me and my brothers. And hearing together all my brothers and sisters singing, a band of brothers and a band of sisters, is tremendously powerful. Why do we sing? To encourage one another. Two more, and then we're done. We sing in order to reach a lost world. We sing because singing is a witness to the world. Listen to Tim Keller. Christian worship is exuberant, never half-hearted, attractive and off-putting, pointing to God, not the participants. There is nothing more evangelistic than this kind of worship, as far as the world is concerned. We've had people come into our church who didn't understand the gospel the first time they came in. That's not surprising. We live in a post-Christian society. One of the things they say to us, however, is, it's amazing. Yeah, the way in which you see, they never experienced anything. And the love that they experience, the fellowship that they experience. Very often people hear the gospel in the context of what they see. And what they hear and what we see. And when we sing, we testify. We testify to the gospel. We proclaim Christ and people hear it. I was converted in 1967. And the first thing I began to pray for when I was converted was for the conversion of my mum and dad. You have parents or brothers or sisters or even spouses who are not converted, maybe kids who are not converted. That was the huge concern of my heart. My mum and dad were not particularly interested. They were lovely and right, but they weren't interested. And then in 1973, I sang in a musical called Come Together. Anybody remember Come Together from the 70s? You know, one or two grey hairs out there. And it was a wonderful musical, the Owens, Jeannie and Carol Owens. And it was a wonderful gospel musical. Now, and we sang it in scripture, we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned every one to his own way. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And, you know, great music, great, just simple gospel stuff. And I managed to get my dad to come along to it. 6 months later, he was visiting me in college, and I gave him a tract. And 3 days later, I got a letter through the post, and he said, I came and talked to him. Read that little book on the way home. And when I got home, I went up into my bedroom. I got down on my knees and asked Jesus to be my saviour. Is that okay? Yeah. I look back now, and I asked him about it, and he said, when he was baptized, the thing that got him thinking was going to that musical, Come Together, hearing the word of God. The purpose of preaching, or the purpose of singing, surely is to witness the gospel to lost people. So when you're singing, bear that in mind. Here's the last thing, and then we're done. Singing prepares us for heaven. Singing prepares us for heaven. What are we doing when we're singing? We're having a foretaste at the end of the journey. Taking us back to where we started this morning, look at the book of Revelation, it's not just one song. In chapter 5, it's actually one in chapter 4, and then it's scattered through the book, chapter after chapter after chapter, singing God's praises. One of the great characteristics of heaven will be singing God's praises. And so we need to be singing about heaven. There is a hope, for example. One of my favourites, and have you ever seen The Sands of Time Sinking? Anybody sing that these days? That's a great hymn. Originally, there are 27 verses, so you don't pick and choose, but it is a brilliant song. Rediscover the sands of time and sinking. My father-in-law was the most godly man I've ever known. And at the age of 80, 83, I think it was, he planted a church in Wiltshire. That was, you know, the calibre of the man. When it came to the end of his life, and he was almost out of this world, he had Welsh roots, a Welshman. And he got to the point where he was not really very conscious. We as a family gathered, wife and I think three of our kids, we didn't have, one of them wasn't able to make it, but three of our kids with their wives and the wife and myself, and we stood around the bedside. And he got to the point where he could barely hear anything. He was unconsciously limited. And I said to my wife, well, should we read? She said, no, that's not sure. Let's sing to him. I'm the same, my family is not the Mallard from the traps. Okay? But we sang as best we could. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Pilgrims from this background. When I tread the verge of Jordan, being my anxious fears subside, death of death, hell's destruction, land me safe. On Canyon side. Next day, he landed safe on Canyon side. I like to think of him leaving this world to the voice of song and entering into a new world to the voice of song. What are we singing, or what are we doing when we sing? We're preparing God's people for that final journey. where they will be singing like nothing you've ever imagined forever and ever. You can't sing that singing, voices will be provided when you get there. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for calling us to belong to you. There's nothing more important than that. Lord, help us to articulate both in word, in music, in song, all the joy and the glory of what it means to belong to our Redeemer. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much, Paul, again, for just illuminating our hearts and our minds. We're going to sing an old hymn to a slightly different tune. It's actually the hymn, Sovereign Lord, We Sing Your Glory, but it's to a familiar tune, which is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Shall we rise to our feet and let's sing this song together.
Eternal throne. our brethren's rest. But why don't you just spend a few moments of quiet, just in prayer in your own hearts and minds. And there's been so much to reflect on. We've been so wonderfully fed, haven't we? Just time to reflect, just for 2 minutes, to pray in your own hearts and minds. Guys, he's going to put a link on there. He didn't normally do some church meetings, but could you get your mobile phones out? That'd be really helpful. So if everyone get your mobile phones out, if you've got one, and got one, don't worry. And we're going to do a Q&A time, a question and answer time, in about 8.5 minutes, okay? And what we'd like you to, if you go to that link there, link tree with a dot in the middle of the E's, music ministry, on there, we use that thing to give you a whole bunch of links. There's links to our Spotify playlist, if you want some good songs, to book on other things and find out more. But also on there, there's a link to our Q&A kind of question times. You can post a question. Abby has already posted a question, and we love you, Abby, because you put that question on there first. But you can do it anonymously. Post your questions. If you have, I don't know about a question, I'm not sure what to post, you can like other people's questions so we can see which is the most popular. I'd like you to all go on there, have a look at questions, post questions, and I'd like to be back here in 7.5 minutes. We will give you a shout. Go stretch your legs, go to the toilet, whatever you like. Let's be back here in about 7.5 minutes. Thank you. Also, the bookstore is still open if you do like to grab them. Obviously, you haven't been there yet.
Can I just use this for the questions?
Yeah, that's fine.